Hi everyone, my name is Theodor Mitev, and in this short lecture I will discuss the testing stage in developing digital artifacts. This is the sixth lecture in my series on digital artifacts, following the lectures on thinking, observing, defining, ideating and prototyping. As a reminder, in the lecture on thinking we discussed getting started with conceptualizing your project. In the observation lecture, we examine ways to find, to observe and understand your users. In the lecture on the defining stage, we discuss the production of a definitive problem statement, which ends up framing the project from then on. In the lecture on ideation, we talked about generating a wide spectrum of ideas to address the problem statement you've done in the previous stage. When we talked about prototyping, we discussed making tangible models of the problem solutions you generated during the ideation stage. So, as usual, I want to emphasize that these stages are part of a continuous developmental process, which is iterative, and which builds around a feedback loop with your users. It's very important to understand also that these are not sequential or linear steps that, that you take one after another. You should be rather thinking of them as modes of thinking and modes of doing when it comes to your project. And so these modes can be adapted during each phase of your project, and they could be iterated cyclically through, and they could be working concurrently with each other. So it's really important to understand that the key element here is the cyclical and iterative nature of the process. All right, so to begin our discussion of the process of testing and the testing stage of the process of developing a digital artifact, I've chosen this quote from Mark Hatch, who is the writer of the Maker Movement Manifesto, and he points out that sharing and engaging a public is an essential aspect of the process of making, right? If you make something and don't share it, was it even made? If no one saw it, if no one engaged with it, if no one could give you feedback on it, if no one could test it and give you some interesting ideas on how you could change it and improve it, right? Was it even made, if the only audience for that thing is you? So it's really important that you take this on board and make this your motto when it comes to the testing stage. Share it, share your process, share your finished prototypes with your users, and be open to feedback. And this is the fundamental aspect of what testing is about, right? It's testing your prototypes with users. It's all about getting feedback and correcting your assumptions. Remember that if your assumptions were wrong, right? If your assumptions, the assumptions that you generated first in the defining, then in the ideating, then in the prototyping stages, right? So these assumptions that you've had about what you need to be making, but you've tested them with users and they've proven to be wrong, all you need to do is iterate, right, and start again. That's why this process is described as cyclical and iterative. If your audience corrected your assumptions, you need to iterate. You should not be stopping your project, you should be iterating on it. Speaking of which, you should be thinking of the testing stage as an natural endpoint to what you were doing during prototyping, right? So in prototyping, you were creating physical models of whatever it is that you're working on. And the natural endpoint of that process is evaluating them, right? Evaluating their utility, their goodness, their value for users. And this is what testing does. Hence, testing is the natural endpoint of prototyping. But on the other hand, testing allows you to get feedback, right? It allows you to further understand your users. It allows you to gain further insights, probably the most valuable insights that you could get so far, about your users. So from that different perspective, testing is also not only the endpoint to prototyping, but also the natural beginning of a new iterative cycle, because it generates a new cycle, a new stage of observation, a new stage of defining, ideating, etc. Hence, testing is between prototyping and observing, and it is the fulcrum around which the entire feedback loop is cycling. So it's really important that you approach it in this way, as a natural endpoint of prototyping and as the natural beginning of a new cycle of observing, ideating, etc. All right. So now that we know what testing is and where it is positioned in terms of the overall cycle of producing a digital artifact and releasing it for an audience, etc., etc., what the really pertinent question here is who do you test with, right? How do you even begin testing? What does it look like? So from our perspective, early on, when you start, when you're in the very beginning stage of testing your prototypes with your users, you should be aiming at your regular users, right? So these are the people that you are actually expecting to be using whatever it is that you are making, the people for whom you are generating social utility. So you need to be finding those users, right? We've talked about this before in previous lectures, and you need to be observing their behavior, and you need to have a clear understanding of their insights and of their needs, and you releasing your prototypes for these users, right? So these are your regular user groups. If this is a podcast on, let's say, gaming, then you need to be releasing to a specific regular user group which is interested in these kind of games that you're covering in your podcast. If this is a Twitch stream dedicated to cooking, then you want to be targeting people who are interested in this kind of Twitch streams, you know, which deal with cooking. The situation changes though as you start getting enough information, and as your prototypes and as your digital artifact progresses and advances. So as you develop, as you advance along the iterations of your prototype, and you become better and better, and you start hitting that that audience's needs, and you are pretty sure that you have a clear understanding of that regular user group that you're creating for, it's really important then to start thinking about targeting your non-regular users, or your super users, if you will, right? You can call them any name you like. The point is that these are users who are outside of that bell curve, which you would normally target. So these are, for example, when it comes to, let's say you're doing a website on horse riding, and your normal regular users are people who are just beginners when it comes to horse riding, and they don't really know that much about horse riding, and you are there to tell them, you know, what they can expect, what the mistakes are, etc., etc. Your non-regular users in this case are two types. On the one hand, these are people who are really experts on horse riding, and they are really interested in horse riding. They have a tremendous amount of knowledge. You should be testing with these types of people, right? You should be identifying where can you find an audience which is really passionate about whatever it is that you're making, far more passionate than you maybe, right? So they are your super users, as it were. You should be trying to gauge their reaction to your project. And conversely, you should be testing with people who have absolutely no interest and no overlap with this project, who are interested in something completely different. You should be trying to gauge their reaction as well. Why? Why is this important? Because the reactions of these non-regular users will reveal to you things which are not normally visible if you are talking to regular users only, right? They would reveal to you aspects of your project which you wouldn't normally consider, and they will reveal them to you from two vastly different perspectives, for that matter, the perspective of the super engaged user, the user with maximum skin in the game, as it were, and then the perspective of the user who is actually not interested at all, who for whom this is some, you know, random oddity. All right, so you've started testing, and it's important to keep in mind a few things when you do so. First and foremost, you need to have very clear objectives. You have to have need to have a clear perspective on what aspect of your project you're testing with users. What is it exactly that you want to find out from users about your project? It might be related to, I don't know, sound quality. It might be related to the topics you're covering. It might be related to future iterations. It's entirely dependent on your project, obviously, but you need to have a clear objective when it comes to what is it that you're testing, because this is the vector you are trying to test, right? This is the vector for which you're looking for feedback. And when you are doing that, when you have that clear objective in mind, you need to obviously, and this appears obvious, but for whatever reason, many students make the mistake of not doing so, you need to test in the environment of your users. Right? So you need to try and be where your users are. So this means that if you're targeting people who are interested in a specific topic, you need to test your content, even if it's sitting on another platform, you need to test it on the platform where they normally are, right? So if your users normally are on can be found on Pinterest or on a specific subreddit, then that's exactly where you need to be testing your content, because this is the normal environment of your users. The third point, which is related to the first, when you set a clear objective, you need to ideally test at least several, if not multiple, prototypes. So you need to iterate to prototypes quite fast. So think of testing here as a natural extension of prototyping, like we already mentioned. So you're iterating through, let's say, a number of prototypes, and you're testing them continuously on the go while taking note of the feedback you're getting. Why? Because it allows your users to give you a number of responses on that specific objective or that specific aspect of your project that you're testing, and also it allows users to compare alternatives and give you a general feedback on different alternative versions of whatever it is that you're making. Hence the importance also here, and as an aside, of creating as a series as opposed to creating as a singular object. When you're creating a singular object, you are precluding yourself from having access to all of that feedback that you would normally get. Whereas when you're creating as a series, you're naturally building on the ability of the audience to compare alternatives, and you're naturally leveraging this aspect of, you know, releasing multiple prototypes, releasing early, releasing often. Concurrently, as you are releasing your prototypes for testing, you need to obviously observe your users and the way they interact with your prototype. You need to let them interpret whatever it is that you have released. You need to let them deal with it on their own terms. Let them play with whatever that object, that artifact is. Again, remember, because of the vast spectrum of possible digital artifacts, I have to be very ambiguous here, because you have all sorts of different possibilities. But in all of them, you need to allow for the unexpected in the way your users engage with the content, and you need to observe that while resisting the urge to defend your prototypes. This is really important, because you're looking for feedback. If you start defending your prototypes during the testing stage and engaging with your audience on the terms of defending your work against criticism, you are not actually looking for feedback. You're not getting any feedback. All you're doing is defending your work, and you should be restraining yourself from that at all costs. Resist the urge to defend your prototypes. Focus on getting feedback. And if you do that, then you opening yourself up for all sorts of interesting insights, because you should be looking for surprising user reactions, for things that are unexpected, for things that you would construe as mistakes when it comes to user reactions, things that you would construe as misuses, maybe. All of these, everything that strays away from the narrow frames of what you expected, are really important learning moments, and you should be taking note of them, right? So documentation here is keys. One of the hidden and very important aspects of the testing stage. You should be documenting meticulously each and every interaction that users have with your content, and specifically looking for things that you didn't expect, things that are surprising. In that context, negative feedback is really good. Why? Because it helps you uncover problems, right? It helps you iterate. Remember, if you adopt and take on board fully the notion of, you know, hashtag FIFO, right? Fail early, fail often, or the way we called it in the previous lecture, hashtag BIBO, build early, build often, then negative feedback can only be good because it helps you to iterate fast. It helps you to uncover problems quickly, right? This is how, if you recall, we talked about the open source movement and how bugs could be discovered very fast by a large group of people. This is how this is done in practice, right? So negative feedback is good. Look for it. Look for ways to iterate quickly away from that problem that has just been discovered. And again, I want to repeat it again, emphasize it. Document your findings. Document everything. Screenshot everything. And we talked about this in the previous lecture on prototyping in the context of Eric Raymond's The Cathedral and the Bazaar. And I'm returning to this quote again. Often the most striking and innovative solutions come from realizing that your concept of the problem was wrong, right? How can you realize that effectively? Through user feedback. How can you get that user feedback effectively? By testing, right? So it's a very simple process once you understand it, but you need to remove yourself, as it were, from the position of the creator defending their work, right? You need to open yourself to all possible feedback, including the negative feedback, because it shows you that an assumption was wrong, and it shows you where you need to go next, where you need to iterate. So once you've taken this on board, then you can start taking notes of things that worked, right? So aspects of your project that worked exactly as expected and were received positively by your users, and things that could be improved, things that got negative feedback. Take note of all reactions that you've encountered. Maybe there were new ideas, right? So often when it comes to feedback, users will give you ideas that you, again, as the creator and as the person that you you know, knows the most about the process that you've just undergone and about the digital artifact that you've made, often being that person, you are resistant to new ideas because you think you know best. But you need to resist the urge to take that defensive stance, take on board new ideas. Because again, once you take them on board, you have a detailed amount of observations from which you can build your next iterations, right? So, and this brings me to the next point. Analyze the feedback and all the notes you've taken and iterate accordingly. This is the iterative aspect of testing, the cyclical aspect of testing. So analysis is really important, and it's only possible insofar as you've taken notes, as you've observed how your users interact, as you've insofar as you've been documenting those interactions meticulously. And again, once more, a reminder that this process is not linear, right? And it's not sequential. So this means that you should be doing this continuously as you go. In terms of analysis based on notes and iteration, I'm returning again to a quote from Eric Raymond, again, The Cathedral and the Bazaar. This is from the previous lecture on prototyping. You often don't really understand the problem until after the first time you implement the solution. The second time, maybe you know enough to do it right. So if you want to get it right, be ready to start over at least once. What does this mean in the context of testing? It means taking note of the way your the first test has been received, or the second or the third. Observe your audience carefully, document those interactions, document all feedback, and analyze them so that you can understand the problem. So think of this as a better way to understand the problem that you're tackling, or the issue that you are exploring, or the audience that you're trying to reach. Be ready to start over at least once. There is another very much related quote from Mark Hatch from the Maker Movement Manifesto. You observe an effect, then build a theory to fit the observation. You need to observe the effect of your prototype, right? After testing, you need to observe its effect, and only then you can start analyzing carefully all of the data that you've received, analyzing all feedback to and again here another caveat: the more prototypes you release, the more feedback you're going to have, the more interesting feedback you're going to have. So again, another indication how important it is to serialize your content release. And only after that you can start theorizing and analyzing the data to understand what has actually happened, to understand that feedback and to gain better insight about your audience and about your project and about the essence of what is it that you're making. And moving on from there, you should be looking for continuous interactions with your users, right? So this is not, remember, these are not one-off interactions where you're releasing a finished object and something happens and then you take note and then you go home and it's game over. These are continuous interactions. This is an iterative process which is unique to the internet. So this is one of the emergent properties of the internet. So try to continuously generate follow-up interactions with your users, because this will allow you to understand even more about, again, the user group, about the process of creation that you're engaged in, about the project that you're working on. Look for further insights, dig deeper, try and figure out where could you go next, where should you go next, how should you iterate further. It helps when you think, when you divide it in terms of what users liked and just draw it in that way as a mind map. My users liked X, Y, and Z. They want changed A, B, and C, and they might do differently PLM, right? So think in terms of likes, think in terms of things that can be changed, think in terms of things that might be done completely differently. This helps you to start charting possible vectors for further development. And this also brings me to an axiom I want all of you to take to heart. And the axiom is: prototype presuming you're right, test presuming you're wrong. So what does this mean? First and foremost, when you're prototyping, and we already talked about this, you shouldn't be evaluating. You should be making, right? You should be gloriously, joyfully making, presuming that everything you make is beautiful and awesome and is going to be successful. But when you're testing, you should be presuming that everything that you've released is open to change. Everything that you've made could be done better, possibly, right? So these are two mindsets. The one is quite liberating, the first one, when it comes to prototyping, because this is the liberatory part of the creative process, the process of making. But on the other hand, when you're testing, the mindset where you're presuming that everything can be improved allows you to get maximum feedback from your users, and it opens you up to everything your users say. It doesn't mean that you have to take on board and build on everything that your users have said, because for whatever reason you might discount that. The point is that you are observing and you are open to all possible feedback. Remember in that context also that it is your assumptions that are really important here. So if you've building certain assumptions in your digital artifact, in whatever it is that you're making as you're making it, and when you test those assumptions in practice with your users, your users might prove your assumptions wrong. So what, when that happens, this is not a sign for all systems stop, and it's not a computer says no moment. This is a moment where you simply iterate based on that feedback. So it's a, you should be treating this as a very proactive, as a very generative and a positive experience, right? Even if the feedback is negative, it just shows you that you need to go in another direction. And remember again, from our perspective, all that matters when it comes to your digital artifacts is your process, your the intensity of your iterations and your engagement with user feedback. So from my perspective, the testing stage is characterized by yet another variation on hashtag FIFO, in this case, test early, test often, hashtag T Tito. So test as early as possible. Release content to your users for testing as early as possible, and release it as often as possible. Iterate as often as possible through content, because this speeds up your developmental process tremendously and opens you to huge non-linearities when it comes to all these interactions, utility, etc., etc., etc. All right, that's it from me for this lecture, guys. Thank you all for listening. As always, you can reach me on Twitter at TedMitchy if you have any questions, and see you online.